Well, I'm here at the podium again, and I'd like to thank all of you for being here. Because when we sent out the invitations, we threw a wide net. We had no idea who would say yes. And we're so happy that all of you did. We also reached out to other groups, education and so on, but I guess some people are reluctant because they don't know exactly what they're getting into. This is not a topic that perhaps people are comfortable with, even though I would imagine a lot of people are concerned about. But in any case, we're very, very happy that all of you are here. And tomorrow we'll have another group, an additional set of people as well who can't make it today, but they are on our list and they've said yes and they will participate there. I know that some of you will not be able to be there, but I'm very happy that you are here. And we are all here because we are deeply concerned about violent extremism. There are people here today from government, civil society, churches, mosques, schools, and universities. Whereas different sectors of society have a role to play in addressing the problem of violent extremism, I would first like to speak about the place of universities in this endeavor. Academia aspires to probe into the issues of these kinds of issues through research. But it is important that while professors and students stand at a distance from society to conduct careful, painstaking research and think deeply about issues, that they do not withdraw into an ivory tower and become aloof from others. Universities today are required to engage with partners in the community in order to conduct research that is meaningful to society. The Carleton Center for the Study of Islam has a mandate to work with a larger Ottawa and Canadian community. We seek to work with government and civil society, as well as with community groups to address issues that are of common interest. The center has adopted the Carleton motto, pursuit of knowledge and human advancement. We believe that the pursuit of knowledge should be tied to human advancement. The research that we conduct and the activities that we hold are consciously designed directly to have an impact on human advancement. Our particular scholarly area of the study of Islam and Muslims is directly relevant to the future of Canadian society. The work that we do adopts an academic and critically analytical approach. In addition to organizing scholarly lectures and research, we also work with partners and have had lots of success in working with non-academic partners like the Canadian Council of Muslim Women, with whom we did a research project. And I'm not sure where Nadia High is sitting right now, but oh, there she is. And she was the lead researcher for us as a PhD student working with the Canadian Council of Muslim Women. And of course, now we are working with the IDI as well. And Dr. Runte talked about the importance of education, and that's what we believe in. That's what why we're doing this. This is the thinking behind the ideas in the workshop in terms of religious literacy and education as a whole. This is the problem that we are talking about, the problem of violent extremism. Of course, many other issues, many other ways of dealing with that problem have been suggested, mostly security-based, military approaches, etc. Governments talk about counter-radicalization, community resilience, of course, has been an issue, something that we've worked on together with the Canadian Council of Muslim Women. What we are looking at now is the role of education, because the problem seems to be a very, very long-term problem. It's not a short-term problem. Most governments, most militaries are exercised on eliminating ISIS. Unfortunately, and we all know this at the back of our minds, the problem is not going to disappear with the destruction of that group. It is a problem that is much, much bigger. And so we hope with education we can start looking at the long-term nature of this problem and start developing solutions. This won't be a magic solution, it won't be a quick fix, but it is a way to try and understand how people think, how they come to understand what is their religion, what is Islam, what should they be doing as Muslims. And the, and you know, as Ali Asani says in his chapter, which I sent out to you, how do we know what we know about Islam? That's a question that both Muslims and non-Muslims should be asking themselves. Because there's a lot of misunderstanding even among Muslims. So in terms of the workshop, we have sought to work with all of you in a format that provides for a pluralistic and democratic approach. We really take this seriously. We recognize that there may be people in this room who do not agree with each other on certain issues. But that's what we mean by pluralism, that we don't all agree with each other, but we are in the same room, we are in the same city, we are in the same country. And where is Farid Panjwani, who's come all the way from England? There you are. Thank you so much for making the trip. Really appreciate it. And tomorrow, of course, we'll also have another person, Ali Asani from United States. So we truly believe that bringing people together who don't necessarily agree with each other is a way to begin the discussion. We may debate, we may discuss, we may disagree, but the idea here is not to have a nice package at the end, but the start of a project, of coming together, sharing various ideas, putting them together and seeing, okay, these are the different perspectives that people have talked about. And this is why the democratic side is so important here, that we all come together and have an opportunity to say our piece, to contribute to the discussion. And that's what we're hoping that all of you will be able to do today and tomorrow. So and speaking of the problem that we are looking at, how are we to think of it? Firstly, how do we understand the problem of violence? This is an issue that has beset human society since time immemorial. And I don't think it's going to disappear anytime soon. It is not only criminals and terrorists who conduct violence, it is also other actors in society like governments. A sociologist, David Kurtzer, speaks of the bureaucracy of violence, police, army, jails. Every society has them. But we never think of them as agents of violence. Violence is much more widespread in society than we admit. So how are we to think of this other kind of violence? So there is, we think of legitimate violence and illegitimate violence. And when we talk about extremist violence and averting it, what exactly are we talking about? I don't have any prescriptions. What I'm urging you to do is, in the discussions we're going to have, let's not just take things at face value, because we know there are various kinds of debates on terminology, and terminology can be a trap. The oft said phrase, one man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter, and so on, that's just scratching the surface. What about the words like Islamic, jihad, caliphate, fatwa? These and other words that come from the vocabulary of Muslims have become so distorted and sullied and corrupted by people who do not seem to care about the value and the sanctity of the words in the context that they were developed. So we need to think about the notion of violence in that context, the notion of other words and concepts that shape these discussions of us on a daily basis in the media, in government, in society in general, at the dinner table, in the family, and so on. My second point is that currently, most governments are working with the idea of countering radicalization and extremist violence. Now, I might be unfair to them, but this would seem to imply that policies and programs are developed to push back extremist violence once it has already set in. And so we are trying to counter it. Perhaps we should go back further and look for ways to avert radicalization and extremist violence by addressing its roots. Now, I wasn't going to do this, but I can't help saying what I'm going to say next. There's a certain MP from the Ottawa region who said, infamously, the roots of terrorism is terrorism. So a tautological argument, not looking beyond that, that this is it. We don't need to look at what really the problem is. We just need to attack it and destroy it, and that'll be the end of it. Well, it doesn't. Unfortunately, it doesn't work that way, and we all know that. Religions have been profound sources of promoting harmony and peace between human beings. They have also been used to promote, unfortunately, some of the most brutal cruelty and violence. And that is happening today. There seems to be hardly any religious community whose hands through history have not been bloodied. But then, today, it seems to be, of course, that Muslims are in focus with respect to this issue. How does one speak of Muslims in this context? When the term violent extremism is mentioned, it is groups like ISIS or Daesh, Boko Haram, Taliban, Al-Qaeda, Al-Shabaab or Al-Shabaab that come to mind. The ideology that they follow is exclusionary, anti-pluralistic, and hateful. And of course, it's very violent. It goes against the message that was taught by Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon his name. The religion that has been come to known as Islam embraced Jews, Christians, and others as people of the book. And this was the message of Muhammad and of the Quran, which so many people have forgotten. The question is, how did they forget it? What were the forces at work? What has been happening over the last half century? What sort of curriculum are these people using in their religious education schools? What sort of a mindset is being developed? But perhaps the more profound questions are, who is funding, who is promoting these ideologies, which are exclusionary and seem to go against the message that the Prophet preached? Of course, could argue that what I'm saying is my point of view, they have their own point of view, and perhaps both are equally legitimate. But I'm happy, I don't know if Denise Helly is here yet. Okay, thank you very much, Denise. It's been a while that I've seen you. I'm so happy that you're able to make it. You sent me this today, and I'm so happy with that. It's a report on a meeting that took place recently in Morocco, in Marrakesh, which I happened to be visiting with my wife last summer. It says, religious leaders and scholars from across the Muslim world met in Marrakesh, Morocco, from 25th to 27th January 2016 to endorse the responsibility of Muslims living in Muslim-majority countries to protect the religious minorities living in their midst. The scholars were responding to a crisis. In recent years, several predominantly Muslim countries have witnessed brutal atrocities inflicted upon long-standing religious minorities. In their response, the participants and organizers returned to an ancient document, the Charter of Medina. One of the world's oldest written constitutions, it is a contract of coexistence and freedom of religion in a multi-religious state and rooted in the Islamic experience. It's a long document, but these are the first three paragraphs, which I thought I would share with you. How timely. Thank you very much, Denise. So you can see that there is a counter discourse which is coming forth, and imams and scholars in Islam are putting this forward in a very rigorous manner. It's high time it happened, but I'm very glad that it did happen in 2016, because the crisis has gotten to such drastic proportions. The final issue I would like to raise is that of secularism. We know that Western societies, since the Enlightenment, are fundamentally based on the separation of what is called church and state. And this is an accepted aspect of our society in Canada as well. Now, of course, there are many aspects of religion which still are present in Canadian society, in American society, in French society, and so on. But we go by the model, the general model of the separation of church and state. Now, what has happened is that secularism has almost turned into an ideology as opposed to secularity, which is a softer approach to the coexistence of religion in the public sphere. And we need to look at that more critically as to how does religion, what place does religion have in contemporary society? Now, there have been some recent scholars like Charles Taylor, the Canadian philosopher, Jürgen Habermas, and I know how much you like him, Alia, since you were a PhD student at Carleton. And over the last few years, these scholars have been talking about post-secular society. Now, some people may throw up their arms in alarm and say, what does that mean? Does that mean that there's going to be no difference, no separation of church and state, that the religious groups will take over? Well, that's not what they're talking about. It is amazing that a person like Habermas, who comes from a Frankfurt School kind of Marxist background, is moving towards this. And he is saying that we cannot but acknowledge the place that religion holds in society today, that it has always held for a lot of people, that a lot of people tend to make their decisions about many things in life, in some of them, including politics, based on their religious faith and their religious ideals. We cannot ignore this. We're not saying completely create, you know, a state in which is religious or a theocracy, but we have to acknowledge that our neighbor or a co-worker, for him or her, religion is important. And that's what they mean by a post-secular society. And so how does this affect what we're talking about today? I've worked in education, I've worked in government. And in many sectors of society, including those two, there's a great reluctance to deal with the reality of religion, the reality of citizens who are religious. Well, we have to go beyond that because it is right there. We cannot ignore it. And increasingly, because of the kind of crisis that extremist groups have posed, we have today here people, thankfully. I'm very happy to see that people in the federal government of Canada are here today and they are interested in looking at this issue, because we've come to that point where we can no longer ignore it. Same thing with education. Some teachers, perhaps rightfully so, may see the teaching of religion as perhaps a very, very touchy subject. Of course, there are courses at high school and university about religion, but a lot of teachers are reluctant to deal with it because they don't know what sort of a Pandora's box are they opening here. As a society, we need to develop, we need to look at this carefully, we need to develop ways of pedagogically understanding how to do this better. Also in policy terms, how can we address this so that it does really reflect the reality of the society that we are trying to work with in terms of policy, education, social welfare, etc. The claims that extremists make in the name of religion is something that's very concerning to us. We need to understand that better, and it's only through education that we can begin to understand what I said earlier, how does one know what one knows about Islam? That's the critical question, the critical analytical question that is self-reflexive as to how did I learn about this? Was it through my religious education teacher? Was it on the internet? Was it a textbook? Was it a novel? How did I form these ideas, and are they valid? And how do I test them? These are important questions that all of us should be asking, and perhaps society as a whole. And it is not a matter of converting anyone to a particular religion or a way of thinking or whatever, but these are issues that have become very, very pertinent today. And of course, it has had an effect on the recruitment of young Canadians as foreign fighters and as people who carry out violence in their own countries. Because perhaps they are understanding certain things about what they call Islam in a way that is very, very distorted. So what I'm suggesting that over the next 2 days, this evening and tomorrow, we certainly try and see how can educators, policymakers, civil society, and other societal actors familiarize themselves with religions and understand how religion can be exploited and what are the ways in which it is manipulated. So these are the few issues that I wanted to share with you this evening as we prepare to discuss ways of averting violent extremism. But before I take my chair, I would like to take this opportunity to profoundly thank the volunteers, the many volunteers who've been with us today, all that they've done for us. A number of them have been meeting with us on Sundays, disrupting family life, but we really appreciate it. And they continue to do things for us, giving rides, working at the camera, being at the reception table, and so on. I also like to thank all of my students who are working with me on this project, because it is a very important one, and they believe that it is important. I would also like to thank the rapporteurs, the chairs, and other people who have, of course, today, Harun Siddiqui and Senator Mubina Jaffer, who will be speaking after me, that they have consented to participate in today's proceedings as well.